Let me introduce to you our next speaker, who is Dr. Alex Garza, who you all know is the Assistant Secretary for Health Affairs and the Chief Medical Officer for the Department of Homeland Security. His responsibility at DHS is to ensure that the agency is prepared to respond to biological terrorism and other WMD events. Prior to joining DHS, he serves as the Director of Military Programs at the ER1 Institute at the Washington Hospital Center and as an Assistant Professor in the Emergency Medicine Program at Georgetown University School of Medicine. He serves in the U.S. Army Reserves and currently holds the rank of Lieutenant Colonel, served as a Battalion Surgeon and Public Health Team Chief in numerous deployments, including Iraq and Africa, and has earned numerous awards, including the Bronze Star and Combat Action Badge. Alex is a particularly thoughtful and committed public servant, and we're very lucky to have him here today. Thank you, Alex.
Good morning. That was weak. Good morning. I think I saw most of you in Rhode Island last week, So as I usually do in meetings like this, I try and bring a little levity to the situation by telling jokes, and so here we go. So as a kid, some of you heard this joke before, I had many aspirations as a child. One of them was to be a physician, and so studied hard, went to medical school, went to residency, now I'm a physician. So the other goal in life when I was a child was to run away and join the circus. And so after I got appointed by the president to Homeland Security, I'm pleased to announce I accomplished both my goals. So. And with all due respect to the senator, the Marine Band is a damn good band. So, but thank you, Tom, for the introduction. On behalf of Secretary Napolitano, I want to thank you and the Center for Biosecurity for inviting me here today and holding this conference. I think the research and the thought that you guys put into this is critical for the country, and it helps push us forward as a nation. Now, I don't have to tell all of you the importance of having a robust health and health security biodefense offices within Homeland Security. The reasons are pretty obvious. As I tell my people, although it's not necessarily a party till something gets broken, that's usually FEMA's job, but it's not a disaster until health is involved. And each threat brings its own health security challenge. And these are not difficult to find. Just looking at the headlines for the past year gives you unparalleled crises. We are very lucky that the novel virus H1N1 was not more deadly than it was. This biologic agent was a prime item on the DHS agenda for much of the past year. So the issues that it brought to Homeland Security were pretty diverse. Travel restrictions, border closures, protecting the workforce. Our workforce is mainly made up of people that are mission essential. They carry guns and they guard borders and they patrol ships and do things that you just can't call it in. So it's important that we have a robust infrastructure to protect our workforce as well. So we were lucky in that. Consider the Haitian earthquake and its aftermath. This was a hyper-complex crisis. It spanned multiple different agencies, including DHS, HHS, Department of State, USAID, FEMA. And we all had to figure out a way to work together to come up with an effective response, whether that was coordinating our search and rescue teams, figuring out how we were going to get medical assets into the country, refugee status for people coming back to the country, and in addition, we're sending our workforce to a malaria zone. So we had to encounter that as well. So although I consider our office very integral to public health, we also take a different view, and that view is through national security. And that's what makes our office so unique in the federal government. So in each of these instances, I'm usually sitting by the secretary's side where she's peppering me with questions. And I'm trying to advise her on the health consequences, the ramifications, not only to her workforce, but to society, to our population, to our critical resources, to our infrastructure, and what this health incident is going to mean to national security. We realize, of course, that we can't do this alone. We rely on our interagency partners. We rely on all sectors of the government, NGOs, academia, and our battle space brings these people together, not only in public health and the medical community, but also law enforcement, intelligence, emergency management, first response, critical infrastructure, government, and all these nexuses belong, have these relationships at Homeland Security. So the reason for our department's creation, of course, was to protect the homeland. The expectation was we would be a cross-cutting department, and this is no different for health. And as such, we have to have robust programs to protect the nation from various threats, which include biologic incidents, whether they're natural or intentional. The significance we place on biological threats was recently highlighted in the Quadrennial Homeland Security Review and our bottom-up report. Biological terrorism poses a serious risk to national security. You heard Dr. Inglesby say that. There's fairly universal agreement that the potential consequences of an attack are immense. Even a crude weapon would have large-scale consequences in terms of lives lost, our economic stability, our psyche, and our way of life. Biological equipment is readily available. It's fairly easy to hide. Access to pathogens in the U.S. laboratory may be secure. However, as you've heard, bacteria exist outside of our network, and that should give us pause. The universal control of these agents is a concern, and the pathogens also exist in nature. And so it's not outside of the realm that a determined adversary could use this to their advantage. And the last time I checked, nature is really hard to regulate, and they have a very good lobbyist. Furthermore, we're coming ever closer to the tipping point of biologic sciences. Considering the speed of technological breakthroughs and the ease of use, these advances in our sciences will not be lost to our adversaries, who will attempt to exploit technology and recruit skill needed to advance their agenda on terrorism in all forms. The nature of disease raises immense complexities, from detection and characterization to delivering medical countermeasures, to communicating with an uncertain public, to remediation. This morning, I want to talk with you about three specific aspects of our strategy needed to build capabilities. One priority is our, as Senator Graham discussed, is our BioWatch program. And I swear I didn't pay him any money for that ringing endorsement. But our priority is to advance our BioWatch technology to reduce the amount of time it takes to detect and characterize biological agent. Another is to expand and leverage our partnerships to build end-to-end capabilities, especially in high-risk areas. And a third area is to integrate both of those into technology and partnerships into one to strengthen the biodefense across the nation. So what are we doing to advance BioWatch technology? As many of you know, BioWatch is termed an early detection system. It's capable of detecting aerosolized agents. Its purpose is to mitigate the effects of a large-scale attack, and it operates in more than 30 high-risk areas around the country. The operative word, of course, is early. The technology requires manual collection of filters, transport back to labs, and then the lab technicians do their magic and do their testing. And then we come up with results, and those are usually in the evening after everybody has gone home for the day. So this was a good first effort for biodetection. However, we have to get better. The problem is, as you all know, the process takes more time than we can reasonably afford. So our goals are to advance the technology, to reduce the time it takes to detect and characterize an agent. We've all seen the mortality curves. We know we have to compress the curve. We have to accelerate detection. We have to make effective decisions, or forever we will be held hostage to the tyranny of time. Now, this emerging technology is extremely complex. It's far more sophisticated than the system that we have today. Many of you know it as Generation 3 or Gen 3. The requirements of the program are to have the ability to collect samples, do the analysis, and report out electronically, all at the point of detection. It essentially will complete the actions that we did at the laboratory, and we phrase it as lab in the box, but as I was speaking in Rhode Island, I was beat up for using that phrase by the laboratory people because then they felt like I was doing away with their jobs. But the point is, we will still need lab people to help us out with this. But we absolutely need them in the mission space. But the goal is to have an autonomous system to speed up that cycle. The benefits of this system would be to decrease detection time from 10 to 34 hours to 4 to 6 hours. And as you all know, that time is valuable. So I know you've heard my qualifiers describing the technology. It's extremely complex. We've developed a very rigorous testing and evaluation phase. We have two prototypes that we're evaluating right now. And it's a tough, tough process. We need to make sure we get the technology right. We have to make sure it gets reliable and valid results, and we have to make sure that it does what our stakeholders at the state and local levels need, which is a reliable system so that they can make effective decisions. The department sees this as a priority to ensure the earliest warning possible, and we have to advance this technology. This brings me to a second area of focus that I alluded to with my mention of our partners at the labs. The technology is of little use unless there's people behind it. Unless we're working as a team together for a common goal, the technology is useless. So I always use the analogy of a radar detection system. The radar just tells you that you have aggressors incoming. Unless you have the decision support capacity and the ability to respond, it's nothing more than a sound wave that's bouncing off of matter. And so that's what we're trying to build up with the BioWatch program. And this is one of my priorities, is to leverage our relationships to not just build detection capacity, but to also build biodefense capacities in these jurisdictions. When BioWatch was first established, it was built as an environmental detection system, and rightfully so. The emphasis was on the technology, and to a lot of people that aren't familiar with the program, this is how they see the program, is just a piece of technology. But I would say that that's wrong to think of it that way. Because just like the radar system analogy, we soon came to realize that we couldn't just tell people, hey, you got something bad on your doorstep, go take care of it. We knew that that was not the right approach. So that's why it's imperative that this detection capacity be inextricably linked to public health, both at the community level and at the DHS level. Over the years, BioWatch has matured, and it's built relationships and response frameworks. Because of the success that we've had, we're accelerating this development to build not only biodetection capabilities, but bio-notification response capabilities and response capabilities. We're leveraging our program's partnerships to tackle the even broader challenges of biodefense. We're leveraging the program's infrastructure to drive biopreparedness at the state and local levels. We provide planning guidance, technical expertise to our BioWatch jurisdictions. We team with FEMA to conduct drills and exercises so partners can exercise interpreting BioWatch data, working through difficult decisions, and responding as a team. You definitely do not want to be trying to tackle these high regret decisions in the moment, and that's what makes these drills so important. We work with HHS, CDC, EPA, DOD, FBI, and a couple of other three-letter agencies to coordinate at the federal level, but also to expand relationships at the local level. We support an annual workshop that brings all of our stakeholders together to discuss lessons learned and to share information. The BioWatch structure is centered around our BioWatch advisory committees, which brings diverse disciplines together. And these committees are a microcosm of what we do at the federal level. They bring together the medical personnel, the laboratory experts, the scientists, the intel, the law enforcement, transportation systems, utilities, critical infrastructure, and the state and local politicians. Some of these teams also have partnerships with the military, especially if they're located next to a military base. Now, we all know that biological agents aren't going to stop at the gate and that the MPs will be pretty much useless against them. So in that aspect, we've entered into an agreement with DOD to leverage our resources. They have a partnership program in the military called Guardian that does essentially the same thing. And so we've leveraged each other's capacities to build an integrated system. But the key point is that the day-to-day work of the program leads to new relationships that otherwise would not be possible. These are the same stakeholders that are going to come together no matter what the incident is. Each jurisdiction has its own structure, but the BioWatch partnerships often become the nucleus of biodefense activities. So we're working to expand those relationships in additional jurisdictions. The model works regardless of the community's approach. And as we move into a new phase, we're preparing to introduce BioWatch to additional cities to deploy additional units. You heard Senator Graham say to plan to move them indoors. And this year, we initiate a series of focus groups to get our stakeholders' feedbacks on what we're doing, on the quality assurance, on the technology. We're working with the National Academy of Sciences to establish an advisory committee of subject matter experts to review what we're doing with the program. A couple of weeks ago, I was up in Milwaukee with over 500 people from around the country that participate in BioWatch to hear their views, to listen to their stories, and to problem solve. So the goal is to expand and leverage these partnerships that we've developed, from preparedness to biodetection to biodefense. The third area of focus dovetails the first two, and that's integration of technology and partnerships. Certainly, our nation's biopreparedness is more active than ever, but we got a long way to go. To integrate our programs across the interagency and across the levels of government. So here's one specific example, and that's biosurveillance. Our nation has extensive biosurveillance capabilities. Unfortunately, they're not networked. What we really have now is a system of systems in biosurveillance. And so it's one of my priorities to continue to work with our partners to build a very truly robust biosurveillance capability for the nation. And again, this is a very complex issue. What we have now is an independent network of different systems at the state and at the federal level that serve different purposes. So, and I'm not just talking about human health, I'm talking about animal health, plant health, environmental health, but these all impact national security. As we all know, health data is generated by states and locals at the healthcare facility, and BioWatch program is another critical piece of data that can be brought together. These systems are complementary, and they need to become integrated. And this became clear during Deepwater Horizon, when we all wanted to see the same thing. We all wanted to know what the environmental sensors said, what the human health data was, what the animal health data was, and various other things, and we had difficulty bringing that all together. Now, my office, under the Secretary's guidance, worked to bring this information together, but it was more of an organizing of information, really, than true integration. And so we have to keep pushing for that platform where we can truly integrate this data. And I'm sure many of you have read the GAO reports on biosurveillance about the capabilities, and it's getting attention at the highest levels. There's an immense amount of interest in getting this right. And we continue to work through this problem through our programs, the biosurveillance integration programs that we have. And we've begun to tackle this also at the state level with the state of North Carolina. We've entered into agreement with the North Carolina Collaboratory Project, which is bringing together North Carolina State Computing, the University of North Carolina Medicine, and SAS, the software manufacturer, to try and develop those capabilities at the state level. So the building blocks are in place. Now we just need to accelerate the work of integration. And I'm looking forward to working with all of you here today on this critical effort. We really need to get to a One Health integrated biosurveillance platform. So before I close, allow me to offer one other thought, and that's that we live in a dynamic world. What was worthy of a Nobel Prize a couple of decades ago, a high school student does now in his lab. So we need to be thinking about the future and what its implications are on national security, especially in biodefense. So in addition to my duties at OHA, as if I didn't have enough to do, the President asked me to serve on the Bioethical Commission. And of course I said yes. He's kind of funny the way he asks. But the first task the President directs us to was to consider recent advancements in the fields of synthetic bioengineering. So for those of you who are unfamiliar with this subject, the Craig Venter Institute, located here in the National Capital Region, announced its creation of the world's first self-replicating synthetic genome. Now, some would argue that it's not really that big of a deal, that he hasn't done anything that anybody else hasn't already done. But regardless of what your opinion is on what he did do, it's still an extremely complex process. It still required millions of dollars and very smart people to do it. And the risk of it being used for nefarious reasons is presumably low. However, that's not the point. The point isn't what we're capable of doing today. The point is, what can we do tomorrow? Biotechnology is moving faster than ever before. Perhaps you've heard of Moore's Law, which states that the number of transistors that can fit on a silicon chip would double every 2 years, and so would the power of computers. Not to mention the price for computing capacity has dropped tremendously, and access went global. Not too long ago, computers with no more capacity than my BlackBerry would fill this entire stage. Now, Dr. Rob Carlson a leader in synthetic bioengineering, back when he was a student at Berkeley, noticed the similarities in the biotechnology field. He found that DNA synthesizers a decade ago cost $100,000, and so that only the most pristine labs, the most well-funded researchers could afford them. Now you can buy them on eBay for about 10 grand. So what does this mean to the future of biodefense? Well, it wouldn't be out of the stretch to imagine in the future where you could synthesize genetic code from the internet and have a genetic sequencer. And as everybody I'm sure is familiar with, the genetic code for smallpox is on the internet. And you can buy the genetic sequencer for not too much money. Now, I don't want to sound like a doomsday prophet. That's not what I came here to do. But these things you have to think about. Or as the Red Queen tells Alice, now here, you see, it takes all the running you can do to keep in the same place. And that's how I feel a lot of times. And so we're trying to build the capabilities today. We're trying to look to the future. We need to keep pace with the rapid advancement in technology and the possible threats that lie ahead. So in closing, I want to thank you again, Dr. Inglesby and UPMC, for inviting me to talk. Secretary Napolitano is committed to working with leaders of the nation and all sectors of society to tackle clearly what are some of the most challenging issues of our time. And she stressed the need for partnerships. So you'll be hearing a lot of views today and perspectives throughout the day, and they're all important. And we want to hear your ideas as well. Biodefense is a national security concern, so let's continue working together towards that common goal of protecting our homeland and our way of life. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Alex. Alex has a few minutes for questions, and I think I have a few questions, but I also invite you all up to the microphones if there's anything that you think you'd like to ask Alex in the time that we have. But let me start by just saying, you mentioned H1N1 at the beginning of your talk. Is there anything that you think is worth relaying about what DHS or your colleagues in government learned from the H1N1 experience?
I think a couple of the big things. A big one was that we need to work together very well across the interagency, and I think we accomplished that. I think it really also brought to the forefront of a couple of things. Biosurveillance. So the intelligence told us that it would be H5N1 coming out of the Far East, and it turned out to be H1N1 coming out of Mexico. And so that really puts into perspective the limit of knowledge that we have on emerging infectious diseases. I mean, we know a lot, but your plans have to be flexible enough so that whatever the threat is that you encounter, that you're able to easily adapt to it. And I think that we did a fairly good job with that. The other one was workforce health protection. I think it really brought to the forefront the need to protect the workforce in homeland security in order to achieve national security.
Great.
It brought a whole host of other issues, but I think those were two of the big ones.
Okay. And another program that you're responsible for and we hear a lot about is the National Biosurveillance Integration Center. Could you say a little bit about its current mission and approach?
So the current mission, I tried to bring that together in the talk, is supposed to be a cross-cutting federal agencies, bringing together of data and information in order to have true biosurveillance. It's had fits and starts, no doubt. I think we have it on some pretty firm footing right now. We've been talking with a lot of our interagency partners. We just had our interagency meeting yesterday, and I think we have a pretty good plan going forward. Recognizing that I don't think really that the technology is that big of a problem. I think it's more building those relationships in order to bring people together to truly develop a more comprehensive biosurveillance picture. So that's one of our key goals.
Okay, great. And obviously another big mission of the Department of Homeland Security is to work with the private sector on the range of activities you described. How does that work? Is that your office? Is that another part of DHS? And how are we working on that or improving that?
Right. So. I mean, we work fairly well with the private sector, and of course you cannot ignore them. They are a huge part of homeland security. I mean, most of the workforces in the private sector, would be foolish for us not to engage the private sector. And so I think
where that really came to a forefront was actually during H1N1, where together with HHS, we were engaging the private sector and offering guidance and expertise in how they should approach these problems. And so you have to take that same sort of approach when you're talking about biodefense as well. Mm-hmm. These are the issues, these are the things we worry about. You have to think about these things, private sector, in order to not only protect your people, but to keep your business running, quite frankly. As we saw after Hurricane Katrina, mm-hmm. If your business goes away, there's a good chance that you're not going to come back, regardless of what the threat is. Mm-hmm.
And the other thing that was an important issue that was being worked by government this year was the laboratory security discussions and how that was going to work within the government. Can you say anything about the administration's policy?
No. No, I'm kidding.
Come on.
So laboratory security, look at that, they cut off my mic. So laboratory security is always this fine line you walk.
You see, you cut it off on purpose, or maybe it's distance.
Fine line you walk. They cut me off on purpose.
There you go.
So you walk a fine line. That is between ensuring security and making sure that the people that you pay, that the government gives good money to conduct research, are able to conduct their research. And that's always that's a difficult decision to make. How much security do you want to put in place to make sure that you don't have infiltration from the outside, but still allow the researchers the ability to carry out their important work? And I think the administration, that was of prime when they were deciding what they wanted to do, and I think they struck a nice balance in trying to achieve that. Now, does that mean we put it on the shelf and game over? No. I mean, I think what I brought up there at the end with synthetic bioengineering, I mean, that brings a whole new problem to the table as it advances. And so I view it more as a dynamic structure rather than a static one.
Okay. Okay, on that optimistic note, I think we'll thank you, Assistant Secretary Garza, and we'll take a brief break for 15 minutes. I'll see you back at 10:30.